age.
Yeah.
So I'll go 220 years after my mom.
Bingo.
All right.
They are different.
No, but John, I'm giving you what you want to hear.
Go on. I'm waiting for the evidence.
The assumption is
losing your Dawah channel. It's because you're losing the debate, but it's okay.
Well, by saying it doesn't make it true.
Yeah.
But what I was going to say was that.
That's what you wish, huh?
That'll teach me.
Let's keep it diplomatic. People don't want to see this kind of thing.
No, we're all
no one's being unfriendly. Yeah, I mean, and you're a big guy. You can defend yourself. Don't be a soy boy.
No,
come on.
Fine. So what I was going to say was, John, I was going to say that, for example, your assumption is that Bukhari, because of his compilation of the hadith, that those hadiths were non-existent before his time. And what I want to tell you is that they were actually existent in oral and written form. And I have evidence for that.
I'd like to see it.
Okay, so the evidence, for example, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, who I'm sure you're aware of, he's the second caliph, or the first caliph, after the Prophet Muhammad. He lived with him. He wrote a book himself of hadiths called Kitab al-Zakat.
So we still have this book?
Yes.
Okay, how
many I can't tell you.
When's the first copy? Wait,
can I tell you?
And how many hadiths are
there? No, there's a few hadiths on it.
A few?
No, not a few. There's a lot of
hadiths. How many? What's the number?
It depends on the nuskha. It depends on the...
No, this is an important question.
Hold on.
Because we know how many hadiths later Muslims had by building up Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, and we've got the number.
John, I appreciate that.
If that number of the earlier guy doesn't match the later number, then something's gone wrong.
You talked me today about the moratorium.
Moratorium canon.
Yes, okay. So this is something of my tradition I wish to tell you about, which is that... I'm giving you one example. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Amr ibn al-As.
Can I investigate that?
No, I will definitely tell you.
Okay.
Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Amr ibn al-As, Ali ibn Abi Talib, all of those Sahaba, which were companions of the Prophet, lived with him, wrote books which were around and incorporated and compiled by Bukhari.
Right.
And so Bukhari's mission was not to make his own hadith, it was to put together the strongest in terms of chain of authenticity hadiths that existed already. And so he took, for example, those books of Abu Bakr and Ali and so on.
Yeah.
So that's one point.
Why do the Shia reject them?
The Shia reject them, that's a good question, because they don't accept Abu Bakr.
Right. So the point is,
theological reasons.
Exactly. So you're making an argument about the uniformity of scripture
when your own
scripture is non-uniform.
No, can I tell you something?
Muslims do not agree.
John, the lack of agreement of something is not a proof of its falsity.
Thank you. Remember he said that?
Yeah. The lack of agreement of something is not a proof of its falsity.
There we go.
Otherwise,
I'm glad you said that.
Otherwise, all of our religions would be false.
Right. I'm glad we've established that.
Yeah.
I'm glad we've established that.
So the point is...
Right, so now let's go to Athanasius and the moratorium.
I'll tell you something, right? From an Orientalist perspective.
Yeah.
Orientalist, Western, unbiased kind of... seemingly unbiased, right? But they have their own Orientalist...
Everyone's got prejudices.
Yeah. Those guys, when they look at the historical data, many of them accept the Sahaba as a legitimate authority of transmission. Now, the reason why they do so is because they don't see the theological argument that the Shias put forward. So looking at it from a strictly historical perspective, I think we've come to different results. I wasn't making an argument of the uniformity of scripture. I was making an argument of the presentation of it. And there's a difference between the two. But going back to what I was talking about Athanasius, because we've done a lot of... I've answered all of your questions. I believe I have. And I've tried to be as charitable as possible in doing so, and as honest as possible in doing so, with providing as many evidence as possible. But I think now, the burning question that everyone needs to hear the answer to is this question.
You need to hear the answer to.
Yes.
You don't represent everyone else, you represent yourself, Mohammed.
I need to hear, because I'm confused, let's say. The question is, when it relates to Athanasius, we accept, everyone here accepts, he is the one who made the shortlist, 27 books. This shortlist was that he was a political elite connected to Constantine at his time. This shortlist was then taken on board by other councils, and thereafter, people, some accepted. Constantinople. However, before that time, before Athanasius came up with this shortlist, 27 books of the New Testament as we know them today, were not seen as the uniform New Testament that we thereafter saw it as.
Yeah.
My question is simple. Who gave Athanasius such authority so as to uniformly, unilaterally, autonomously come to a conclusion that those 27 books of the New Testament are the Word of God? That, for example, the Gospel of Thomas.
You made your point.
For example, the Gospel of Thomas is not in it. Revelation, which was about not to be in the Bible, should be part of it.
Well, Revelation moved in and out, didn't it? You know the history.
Yes.
We established, I did ask you, have you read any of Athanasius' works? And you said no.
I said I read through Eusebius. Right.
Yeah, that's not Athanasius.
Yeah.
If you read Athanasius' Contra Mundum, Against the World, you will have the answer to your question.
So can I have it from you? Because you've read it.
Well, yeah, because if you read the book, he's quoting John, Luke, etc. He's doing, wait a minute.
But all 27 books.
He's doing, if you know where Athanasius came from, do you know where he came from?
Alexandria,
yeah. He was quoting the scriptures because
I'm from Alexandria myself.
Because
shame you're not a Coptic Christian.
Because A, he believed inherently the scripture, and C, the community in there were four or five different key areas. There was Gaul, there was Antioch, there was Alexandria.
Yes.
All these communities were using these scriptures.
Yes.
So he could only say what was scripture, what the community was saying was scripture.
Right, so allow me to add to this, to understand what canon is, we have to understand what the debate was about, where it emerged from, and what they hoped to achieve.
Yes.
Right, do you know where the debate emerged from?
Of the canon?
About canonicity.
So, I know that there was a debate.
I'm asking, do you know why it emerged?
I think that answer wouldn't have any for the question.
It would, it's central, it's important.
So it was to do with the, it was actually later, it was the Montanists. So it came, Marcion didn't trigger that. I know what he did, but he didn't trigger
that. So now you're going back to Gnostic.
So you want an answer, so let me answer.
Yes, sir.
So firstly, canonicity and preservation are not the same thing.
Okay.
To conflate the two like you're attempting to demonstrates that you either don't understand the topic or you're being willful about what argument you're trying to make. Because the argument about canonicity is not decisive in questions about preservation.
Okay.
You agree with that premise? All right. So when you said, I was making an argument about preservation based on the fact that we've been talking about canonicity for the last 40 minutes means that your whole argument was based on a false premise.
Let me finish.
The point of canonicity was to decide which book shall be read in the church, not which book shall be read. Now, the fact of the matter is, early Christians, just by knowing the topic, friend. So,
can I ask some evidence for this?
Yes, of course. Yes. Yeah, because when they were talking, if you
and what church are we talking about? The Eastern or the
Western? We're talking about the one church, because there was only one church at this time. So in terms,
what time are we talking about?
We're talking about within the first 400 years. So in terms of this discussion. It was before Chalcedon. So in terms of the church in this dialogue, it was about which books can be read in the church, which books can be taught in the church, not about which books can be read.
So, for example,
I'm trying to give an example.
Yeah, yeah.
So an example is that The Shepherd of Hermes was a book popular amongst Christians and widely read by Christians.
Okay.
It was a book of catechism. As you came into the church, you would be given The Shepherd of Hermes, a copy to read if it was available to read.
Yes.
Now, not all Christians recognized the distinction between that which comes from the apostolic teaching and that which developed from the apostolic teaching, and Christians were confused.
Okay.
So you would go to some churches, and from the pulpit, they would read The Shepherd of Hermes.
Yes.
and teach from it.
Okay.
And that what the argument about canonicity is about saying which churches are the custodian, yes, of the apostolic teaching.
Yes.
So the church in these different centers,
yes,
over a process, yes, came to identify what these scriptures are. So the So the Muratonian canon, yeah, which is mid-second century.
Yes.
So between 100 and 200.
How many books?
22.
Okay.
22.
Which ones were 100?
Right, that's the point. So in the debate around canonicity,
yes,
there were discussions about things that were called proto-canonical and discussions around what was called deuterio-canonical.
Right, okay.
Okay? So a deuterio-canonical book was a book disputed.
Right.
Examples of books...
Revelation.
Revelation.
Okay.
Hebrews.
Yes.
2 Peter.
Yes.
2 John.
Yes.
3 John.
Yes.
These are the kinds of books that were disputed.
Yes.
Okay? Notice, please note, not the Gospels, which is what you were trying to present it as earlier.
I never said that.
No, no, you did. You said the Gospels quite clearly.
No, honestly, I never said that.
Yeah, you did.
Okay, if I said that, if I said that, I retract that. Because I want to make this very clear, actually, right now, because I'm happy you said this. I want to make it very clear that my reading of primary source materials of early church fathers,
yeah,
that it's quite abundant, their references to the four gospels.
Definitely.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that. I've seen it with my own
eyes. So you accept that the church recognized the four gospels?
I would say, in terms of the majority of church fathers,
all church fathers.
I can't say that because I'm not with them.
Right. But all the ones you've read?
All the ones I've read, no, but sometimes they mention two and not the other one, do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
So, but definitely they mention those, yeah? They do mention those. That's not my argument. But can I just, you've made some really valuable points, and I thank you for your enlightening and edifying, a segment, and thank you as well. But I just want to come back now and ask the question in a different way, because I think where you have provided a lot of edification, there are some unanswered questions here. My question is to do with authority, okay?
Yeah.
Now, there was maybe a brief way to attempt to try and answer that question. My question is, we all agree that Athanasius, he's the one who made a short list of the 27 books.
Yeah.
Where before, 27 books were not, there was no consensus that those are the books that were God's word, meant to be read.
But do you agree that they were known?
Which ones?
That all 27 books were known, and that some Christians did recognize them.
Well,
like the book of Hebrews.
That's a good question.
But do you recognize that?
Let me answer that question. So I think that there's some truth in that claim. For example, if you talk about the 13 books of supposed books of Paul,
the letters,
but they're books in letters. sorry, of Paul. I think from my reading, I can correct me if I'm wrong, many of those have a disputed authenticity.
Not many, no.
So there's seven that are kind of, seven of 13 are undisputed, but the rest of them, there is a scholarly discussion on that. Is that correct?
Yeah.
All right.
And there was at the time.
All right, exactly. Right. So that's exactly why I hesitated in answering the question in one word. But here's what I would say to you then. If we're not sure,
sure.
Okay. Well, I haven't even said the thing. I haven't even said that.
Okay, but you're saying we. Speak for yourself, not for me.
Okay.
Don't say we, say I.
I'm sure.
Okay. I'm sure. You're the only one that's not sure.
Okay, well then you guys are here to teach me. What I was going to say was, the 27 books of the New Testament.
Yeah.
Is it central to the Christian faith that we recognize all 27 books as the Word of God?
So that's a question that Christians have disagreement on.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, but to be clear, all Christians do recognize the 27 books. So the question of its centrality is something that we can discuss. But they do recognize them. By contrast, Muslims are in disagreement about their hadiths. So if you're going to make any argument about what is the impact of this disputation about canonicity,
yes,
you should be consistent and apply it to Islam as well.
I've said that to you. I've already told you that Ibn Taymiyyah says he makes the same exact.
Yeah, no, but then you referred back to the Gospels. We're talking about the Hadith.
No. I agree with you. The Hadith. This is my position. Let me just make it clear. You're absolutely right. What you said there is absolutely fair enough. And I'll say to you today on camera, right? Everyone is listening.
I think the first member of the Dawah team that's actually willing to be consistent on a principle. Well done. Well done, Mahab.
What I'll say to you guys today, any Hadith which does not withhold the scrutiny of the historical process of preservation will not only be rejected by me, but will be something I will not accept as having any authority whatsoever.
Well, can you recommend something we can read on that?
Yeah, so there's lots of things we can read on that.
Just one key book that...
Yeah, one book.
That we could go and read.
And yeah, of course, in English.
In English, yeah. Because it's important, because you know, it's a dialogue as well as... You know.
Okay, I'll tell you in Arabic. I don't know.
I'll put it under your video,
What people go through in Arabic, I don't know about English, to be honest. Yeah? Although that guy, what's that guy, Osama Hassan, yeah? That guy that believes in English, he wrote a book in English. I can't forget the name.
Don't know.
But in Arabic, they go through Muhammad's book. And then after that, they've got Ibn Salah's Muqaddimah. There's lots of books. Just to give you that benefit of the doubt, because we don't need to contradict each other on points like this. I totally agree with you, yeah? If any hadith has been shown when rigorously interrogated from the historical process that it does not have a link, a provenance back to the Prophet Muhammad.
You're changing your argument, mate.
But I don't.
No, you're changing your argument. You've just subtly changed your argument. You've stood here for the last 40 minutes making an argument that confuses preservation with canonization and basing that on the disputes amongst early Christians. When I reversed that and said, but Muslims disagree with the Hadith, and therefore you should be
you should
apply similar principles.
But we don't have canonization.
No, one second. Yeah. Now that I'm encouraging you to reverse it, now you're changing your argument, and because you're introducing something new. You're now saying that, it's actually based upon, can we link the book back to its first people?
Yeah.
So now you're changing the thing that we've just been discussing about for 40 minutes.
That's what all historians do.
No, whole historians make consistent arguments. No. You've just changed your argument in the last five minutes.
Let me tell you why. You think I have.
Yeah, that's exactly the camera will show it.
No, John, let me tell you why I haven't. The reason why I haven't is because to know something happened in history, you have to go through witnesses, yeah?
You have to look through evidence.
Of course you do.
Thank you.
Of course you do, John. And there's no doubt about that. But the evidence is of witness testimony.
No, the evidence could be anything. It can be artifacts. It can be first-hand testimony.
No, you're right.
It can be historical accounts.
But witness testimony as well.
It can include witness testimony.
Just in the same way as you probably agree that many of the gospel writers, they might have had interactions with Jesus, and therefore you're willing to take their narrations because they interacted with Jesus. I'm saying the same thing. But we have criteria that verifies. Everyone has criteria.
Yeah, but you've said your criteria.
I would put to you though that you don't have a provenance. Can we prove, that's a different question altogether, but can we actually prove that the four gospel writers have a provenance, all of them, back to Jesus Christ? Do we know who they are?
Well, hold on one second, because he is changing. He's trying to change the argument, and he thinks that we haven't spotted it, but we have.
But even if I make a different argument.
You are making a different argument. He's abandoning the argument about...
Hold on one second.
He is Shaky Stevens. He's abandoning the argument about canonicity because he's realized that if he lays down principles about canonicity, they will blow up in your face in terms of Islam.
The fact that Muslims cannot agree about Muslims.
Yes, you do.
Hold on. Can you prove that?
Because there are hadiths. There are hadiths that Shia use.
But do you call it canon?
Right. No, you don't call it canon.
So what's a canon?
What's a canon? It's an agreed list of books that are reliable to read.
Okay, we don't have canon.
Right, so you don't have a list of books that are reliable to read?
No.
So you don't have hadiths that are reliable?
No, we have hadiths that are reliable. That's a different question.
Okay, can you read them?
Can read them, of course you can.
Right.
Now, here's the thing. What you're doing here, can I be fair and honest with you?
I'm not doing it.
Sorry, Jason.
Yeah, he's not doing it.
What I was going to say is you're confusing the language of Christianity and Christian scholarship.
Fair enough. I'll take that on the chin. That's a fair point.
No problem. So what I'm saying is that you're using the word canon.
No, I agree. I shouldn't use the word canon.
Let me tell you something.
But you have an equivalence. You have an equivalence.
Al-Bukhari, which is, according to the Sunni discourse, the most authentic book of hadith. Yeah. By whose judgment?
Unless it's embarrassing, in which case the Dawah team say it's not. Because we quote lots of Sahih, Bukhari hadith,
okay,
in this park, and Muslims say that they're not believable.
I don't know what they say.
Right, get to your main point.
My point is this. It's not inconceivable on academic grounds for someone to go into the Bukhari, or Sahih Muslim, which is the second most authentic book, and to look at hadiths as weak inside of it. Like Dara Khutni has done that, and many other scholars have done that.
So we don't. Is that the Sahih collection?
Yeah.
So there's the issue of Sahih is being revisited by later Muslims.
No, by early ones.
How can an earlier Muslim than Bukhari visit a book that Bukhari hasn't written?
Yeah, because they were contemporaries.
They were contemporaries.
Yes.
So okay, fair enough. So he's gone and he's disagreed with Sahih al-Bukhari about what's reliable and what's not reliable.
Not all of the hadiths, in some of them.
In some of them. So Bukhari said that these are reliable, and then this other guy said that they didn't.
No, these ones are not yet.
Okay. So now tell me, as a Sunni Muslim,
yes,
why do you reject Shia hadith?
We don't. We reject some of them.
Some of them. Why do you reject those some?
Because they're written by people who have, first of all, they're not written back to the Prophet.
You claim?
No, they will say the same thing. So they are narrating the Imams, not the Prophet. Do you understand? Do you get it?
Yeah.
So the Shias believe in 12 Imams, and those 12 Imams, they're meant to be infallible people that we follow after the Prophet, that are meant to have the same rank as the Prophet, as all the Prophets except for the Prophet Muhammad. Yeah. We say that particular belief is a flawed one. We don't accept it.
Yeah.
So they would say, for example, Al-Husayn, which is Ali's son, is higher ranked than Jesus Christ, for example. Yeah.
Yeah.
We would say no.
Yeah.
We say Jesus Christ is higher ranked than Hussein. All the prophets are more higher than them. So the point, what I'm trying to say is that
I'm glad you've said this.
Their hadith go back to the Imam. So for example, what does Ja'far al-Sadiq say?
So what you're saying is the belief predicates which sources you use.
Of course it does.
Right. So in the same way, Christians, the belief predicates our sources.
Absolutely, yes.
There's no problem with that.
No, I agree.
Okay, fantastic.
So, do we agree?
Can I just say? You know what I call the chain of narration?
Yes.
I call it the chain of fabrication.
It is, yeah.
Because it's not in the same league as Western historiography when you come to the hadith sciences.
So let me ask you a question, if you know so much about it, right? What are the conditions of a sahih hadith?
Well, there's the science of hadith. And I've been onto Mansour's site about the science of hadith.
So what is that? What's the conditions?
No, you've got a massive list. There's a massive list.
Can you give me one or two?
I can't remember the list. Take for example, Surah 1. Surah 1, yeah?
Too good.
First verse. Right. Give me the chain of narration for that.
Okay.
What's the chain of narration?
Sorry, bro. Let's see
if we can give some historical credence to this.
That's a very good question. He asked me, I want you to do the same thing. That's a good challenge, all right? But can I apply? Well, I'll do it for you. Will you do it for me as well, yeah?
Okay.
So, you agree?
I'm sorry, I was distracted, so I didn't hear
that. He said to me,
okay, that'll do.
Give me the chain of narration for it.
Right.